Hi, I just wanted to say a couple of words before I have my surgery on Wednesday. Obviously, really hopeful that it's all going to go well, and I'm planning to see everyone afterwards. But, you know, just on the off chance,
she might die, Lecretia Seales made a video for her family and friends. Not just a see you later video, maybe a goodbye forever.
I've really had a wonderful life. I've been so, so lucky. And I'm just so incredibly overwhelmed and grateful for all the love and support that everyone has shown me.
From then to now, 4 years on, she still wants to live.
I certainly have not given up.
Lecretia and Matt, partners, soulmates, and for the past 9 years, husband and wife.
She was just a vision of beauty. She was absolutely astonishing. She had this beautiful, slim, white, strapless...
It's not strapless.
Wasn't it?
No. The number one priority in my dress was that I had to be able to wear a bra.
Right. They were small straps. So I may not have noticed them. But, yeah, it was a very sheer, beautiful dress.
It wasn't sheer.
Okay.
There was nothing sheer about it.
Look, it wasn't a meringue dress. I remember that much, at least. And, yeah, she looked wonderful.
You said it was the best day of your life.
Well, there you go.
And it was the best day of mine. It was fantastic.
There you go.
Smart, strong-willed, a high-powered Wellington lawyer who at one time advised Prime Minister John Key on justice.
What did he make of your advice?
It was generally accepted.
Used to achieving whatever she set her heart on, until cancer.
And it got through quite a bit of my brain, a quarter of my brain actually.
The tumour was aggressive, lethal.
What did it look like to you?
A multi-tentacled monster.
Lecretia said, I'm really sorry, Mum and Dad. I promised that I was going to look after you when you got old, and now I'm not going to be able to. So, and that's sort of what she's like.
Shirley Seales is confronting what no mother should have to. Confronting her own daughter's death.
That is delicious.
No amount of love or medical treatment can stop Lucretia's decline.
It's not easy being a parent and not being able to help your child. I think that's the hardest thing. Always, you could usually fix things.
Shirley remembers the conscientious, thoughtful child who announced at age 11 she was going to be a lawyer.
And she had this great love of reading. She used to read and read all the time. And she used to get her books in her room and categorise them like a librarian.
Foreign languages, singing, dancing, cooking for friends. Everywhere Lecretia went, her talents were noticed.
She has an extraordinarily good brain.
Former Prime Minister Sir Geoffrey Palmer knows that brain well. Lecretia worked with him for 6 years, first in private practice, then at the Law Commission, helping to write laws to improve life in New Zealand.
A developed social conscience, a feeling about how things could be made better, a law reformer par extraordinaire.
But it was gruelling, 12-hour days, often 6 days a week.
I had to restrict my water intake because I just didn't have time to go to the toilet. So many meetings and briefings to do and, yeah.
But after meeting Matt Vickers one night in a Wellington bar...
Yeah, I just saw a beautiful woman that...
I was wearing plaits. I think that's all you saw.
Then, getting together and marrying, Lecretia reordered her priorities.
I really wanted to have a family. I knew I would be a really good mother because I had a fantastic mother.
Lucretia's life was about to change, but not the way she imagined. First, discovering she could not naturally conceive. Then, embarking on intensive in vitro fertilisation, only for it to fail.
I suppose because any time in my life I've ever really wanted something, I've always been able to get it. I've been lucky like that. And this wasn't something I had that control over. It drove me crazy.
After six rounds of IVF, Lucretia and Matt took it to the next step, planning to spend $50,000 to go to the States to get eggs from a young, healthy donor. It nearly happened. It would have happened if not for one little thing. Lucretia was at night school, on top of everything else in her life, learning to make sugar flowers.
They were gorgeous. They made me happy. And I was quite excited that I was able to do that. I never thought that was something I'd be able to do.
One night, coming home from a class, she crashed her car.
It was on a bend, and one of the neighbours came out and said it had happened there before. So I just thought that I was unlucky.
Unlucky, but not in the way Lucretia thought. She crashed because her left field of vision was impaired. But it would take 6 months for her brain tumour to be picked up. Then, surgery was immediate.
Terrified. Terrified because, you know, they'd given me a big rundown of the risks of it. And they were quite high. So I didn't know if I was actually going to wake up from this surgery or whether I would wake up blind or a quadriplegic. Yeah, so I just didn't know.
Up next.
Have you decided what it is you want to happen with your life?
I would like to have the choice to have my doctor give me something if things just became too unbearable. Mm.
You want a doctor to be able to give you drugs that will kill you.
Lucretia hasn't given up on life. Brain surgery, then radiation, reduced the size of her tumour, and she and Matt travelled the world. They tangoed in Argentina.
Well, you know those girls you see in a nightclub who can absolutely, you know, shake their thing? She's one of those girls. Yeah, she's amazing.
Right after surgery, she couldn't wait to get back to work.
I was being paid and I felt really bad that I was off work. It's pretty unusual for me to have a sick day, so having a few weeks off, I just felt terrible.
And she battled on, continuing to work at the Law Commission on reduced hours until 2 months ago, taking high-powered drugs to slow the growing tumour and its impact on her body and her vision.
See my hand now. I can't see it now. I'm very weak on the left side of my body. That's partial paralysis.
One of the hands that once crafted delicate sugar flowers is now idle.
So my left hand, I have no strength in my left hand or my left arm. I can't really use my left hand to do anything now. Thank goodness I'm right-handed, but I'm super right-handed now.
What are you now being told about the future?
Probably that I've got between 3 and 18 months. That really, actually, the doctors don't know how it's going to end up. If at one piece of the tumour grows and attacks a vital part of my brain, it could be really quick. but most likely it'll just gradually grow and I'll just get more paralysed and less able to see.
What scares you most?
Losing my mental faculties really scares me the most because I've always had a good brain.
Have you decided what it is you want to happen with your life?
I would like to have the choice to have my doctor give me something if things just became too unbearable.
You want a doctor to be able to give you drugs that will kill you?
I would like that choice. What I want to achieve is to have the law clarified that it is not an offence for a doctor to assist me to die in my circumstances.
The law is unclear. Assisting suicide is illegal under the Crimes Act. But Lucretia says not so in her case because she's competent, consenting and terminally ill. And there's other legislation, the Bill of Rights Act, which says she has the right not to be subjected to cruel and degrading treatment. This is the case she's bringing to the High Court. She wants a declaration that would apply to Lucretia alone, that it's okay, legal, for a doctor to help her to die.
I wrestled with it because I love my wife.
Matt is on leave from his senior role at global accounting company Xero to be with Lucretia.
You know, I want her to be alive as long as she can be. But I realised as I thought about it more and as I sort of learned more about what could happen to Krish as part of her decline, I could understand where she was coming from. And I realised that if this is something that she wants and this is something that's important to her, you know, who am I to stand in her way? Who am I to tell her how she should live her life or end her life? Who is anyone to tell her those things?
Lucretia's mum, Shirley, dad, Larry,
put the fork on the wrong side, mate.
Siblings, Jeremy and Kat, who've had close, lifelong bonds.
Had enough to eat?
Who've all played a part in Lucretia's care, have inevitably been asked to support her decision.
When she talked about the right to die, I said to her, I would respect that she would know when it was the right time, as long as she wasn't doing it because she felt she was becoming a burden, because she would never be a burden. You know, it's a privilege to be able to look after her.
But she doesn't want to be a burden, does she?
No, she doesn't want to be a burden.
That is part of your thinking, isn't it, Lucretia?
It is, and I think that's a legitimate thought to have.
She already thinks I have to do too much, don't you?
Yes.
But I don't want to see her suffering either. I wouldn't want to see her suffering. I mean, she's the toughest person I know. She can handle pain like you wouldn't believe. But if she is to a point where she can't stand the pain, then I know it's just pain that I wouldn't want her to have.
It's fair to say there are parts of society that think suffering is part of life.
It's part of, you know, what they believe life is about, right? Do you agree with that? Do you think suffering brings meaning to life?
No, I think it can make you appreciate the good things in life more, but I don't think it brings meaning to your life.
What's your definition of suffering?
Being unable to communicate, being unable to eat, being unable to swallow, unable to breathe, in pain.
And how far away is that point, do you think?
It doesn't feel like it's going to be tomorrow to me. To me, it doesn't feel like it's even going to be in the next year, but it's possible.
You say this is about Lucretia's right to choose, but inevitably, if she's allowed to make this decision, it's going to set a precedent for other people, isn't it?
It will start the conversation.
The conversation has started in other countries, and Lucretia's is just one side of the debate.
In Canada, the government argued that giving people with grievous medical conditions the right to doctor-assisted death would lead to a slippery slope, where the vulnerable were at risk of euthanasia and murder. But the High Court found there was no evidence of that. And in a landmark ruling this year, the Supreme Court agreed, confirming that doctor-assisted death should not be prohibited.
I think there is no doubt at all that there is a big trend around the world, in places like Oregon, in places like Canada, in places like the Netherlands and Switzerland and other countries, to allow doctors to help people who are incurable and who are suffering enormously to terminate their lives early and for the doctor to assist.
Sir Geoffrey Palmer, QC, law reformer, author of our own Bill of Rights, and Lucretia's former boss.
It seems to me the time is well due in a country like New Zealand for the law to be made clear about what circumstances should this be allowed and what the procedures should be when it is allowed.
Up next, if Lucretia is successful in the High Court, then what?
This is actually giving you the right to say, this is it, it's over.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
It's for you.
Thanks. Well, we've started to talk about at what point I would like things to be over.
And what is that point?
When I can no longer recognise the people I love, when I'm no longer mentally competent, or if I am suffering in a manner that I consider intolerable.
And who makes those decisions?
Well, I make the initial decision. Those are my thresholds. And then if I was mentally competent and I reached one of the thresholds, I would like to be reminded that this is a threshold. What do you think? And if I don't feel ready, then I don't feel ready. But if I don't have my mental faculties, then I won't be able to make that choice. I would have made that choice earlier on, and I would expect that to be followed through.
Who do you rely on then to make that decision on your behalf?
Matt, he's my power of attorney, and you know, I would have a written advance directive, which I would have discussed with all of my family and my GP.
So how does that work? Would everyone have to agree that this is the threshold?
No. Just my lead person.
Matt?
Yes. And he wouldn't make a decision in the absence of consulting my family anyway.
How do you carry that responsibility, Matt? How do you feel about that?
I don't know. It's probably fair to say not many people will have experienced that, so, you know, there's not a lot to go on.
This is actually giving you the right to say, this is it, it's over.
Mm-hmm.
Giving a doctor permission to end your wife's life.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's the fulfilment of her wishes. It's the wishes that she'd set out and made clear in a state of mental competence. It's, if I had any doubt that it's not what she wanted, I wouldn't be able to follow it through. She has been very clear. that this is what she wants. Haven't you?
Yes. And I do not want you to have a mad wife to look after.
Really?
Yeah.
You could tolerate a little bit of madness, Matt, couldn't you?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Well, this is the question, I suppose. But
if I am mad, then I've already died in my own mind.
Look, the decision is ultimately going to be, you know, is my wife suffering? Is my wife suffering? And can I see that she's suffering? Is there any hope that she won't suffer? Is there any hope that she'll come back to me? And when that's clear, you know, then I'm compelled, I would be compelled to follow her wishes and to instruct the doctor to proceed with what she'd decided.
I've got nothing to complain about. It's been terrific and, you know, I'm not into self-denial, so I've eaten a lot, I've had a lot of fun. It's been fantastic and I love everyone who's been there along the way with me. Thanks.